We've often spoken of the rural-urban divide on this show. It's been manifesting itself for years now. The latest census data bears it out, showing 20 of New Mexico's 33 counties losing population. Now, while the state overall isn't gaining many residents, most of the counties that show the biggest gains are home to New Mexico's largest cities. Now, when it comes to the census, fewer people means less money. But beyond that, Dan, what's the upshot here? What are we being told here about New Mexico?
Well, I think, you know, definitely that there's an influx. I think if you look at the data, there's an influx of people from out of this state moving into the state from, you know, bigger states, right? People leaving California, people leaving New York, and they consider Albuquerque to be a much smaller town. Mm-hmm. And they're willing to settle in Albuquerque, where in the past you would find somewhat of a combination of people not only moving to places like Albuquerque, but moving to towns like Roswell and Carlsbad because they'd still want that community. You got to remember too, when you look at these percentages, when you go to places like Catron County, if they lose one person, it's a huge swing in the demographic breakup. But you know, the one thing that is interesting to see is that, you know, the counties that are really losing folks are heavily Republican counties in New Mexico. Yeah. It's going to have a huge outcome in legislative races.
Can I ask you to hold that? I got something for you on that very subject coming up here in a little bit. But let me swing to Jess on that. Obviously, you know, you're right in the middle of it, Jessica. You're seeing folks. What on the ground, what does this mean as a fundamental change to New Mexico in those counties that population's losing?
You know what? It's kind of interesting that Dan said that we are actually growing in Southeast New Mexico. Uh-huh. Eddy County, Lee County had some of the highest returns for the census in mm-hmm. growth. And, you know, we can attribute that to many things, but most people attribute it to the oil and gas industry, which is based in this region, mm-hmm. which is great for us. But you're also talking, as Dan said, about that shift in politics. You know, we are looking at rural counties, which are largely conservative and who already feel disconnected from what's happening in, you know, the center of the state and its urban populations. So you talk about that urban rural divide, the consequence might be just that you see that widen a bit more and you see a bit more of that lack of civility and lack of understanding when we all try to come together on issues that affect the entire state.
Mm-hmm. Sophie, the power balance in a lot of cities around the country is shifting urban, that's for sure. What are the ramifications for New Mexico? I mean, it's already somewhat Albuquerque-centric as it is. Do you know what I mean by that? I mean, does this exaggerate that problem?
I do. Mm-hmm. I do. I think that it does. And one of the big challenges that it's going to create for our rural communities is, you know, potentially less of a customer base for their businesses, mm-hmm. less opportunity to attract doctors and pharmacists mm-hmm. and lawyers. I worked earlier on a couple years ago on a project trying to address the lawyer shortage in rural parts of the state. This just does not help. I think one of the real concerns is there'll be a contraction, especially of essential services. Mm-hmm. for parts of the state that are seeing shrinking populations. It's already a struggle to keep hospitals open in many parts of the state. And so, people do what they do. And the move to cities is not something that, although we sometimes talk about, like, how do we reverse that, et cetera, individuals are going to act in their own self-interest, or, you know, what's best, we hope, mm-hmm. at least, mm-hmm. that's what the economists tell us, that they're going to act in the way that's best for them, to the extent that the perception is that you're going to get something more, perhaps, in the urban areas, that's going to continue to be a challenge mm-hmm. For communities in the rest of the state.
Mm-hmm. Dan, you started to touch on this in a roundabout way, but many of us have been working from home for months, and the concept of going to work is less relying on location now. And you just mentioned, of course, folks are moving into certain parts of the state to be able to work from afar. That would seem to be a selling point for smaller cities and towns, right? What's keeping them from leveraging this more
I mean, mm-hmm. that's where I think Albuquerque's seeing a bigger set of growth than the rest of rural New Mexico. If you're leaving Los Angeles, Albuquerque is a pretty rural community to move to.
Good point.
You know, mm-hmm. Carlsbad and Roswell are way out in the hinterlands, mm-hmm. right? I mean, people still want to get to their Starbucks, want to get their yep. flight options. But the bigger question that's going to arise in New Mexico, I think, in the coming years in the not too distant future is going to be the water debacle. I mean, we are in a drought of epic proportion. And as Albuquerque grows, there's only so much water that can go around. And there's places like southeastern New Mexico. Mm-hmm. When you look in that whole Pecos River Valley, the whole Pecos Valley, where they've done a great job managing their water over the last 20, 30, 40 years. And there's going to be a move, you watch, that says, hey, listen, do we need to be as much of a farming agriculture state and grow alfalfa and grow pecans, or should we be shipping that water to Albuquerque to feed people, to give people drink that are moving here? Right. And I think that fight's coming, especially with the recent decisions in the last year or so with the Supreme Court and our fight with Texas. Things are not boding well for rural New Mexico when it comes to water and sustaining the ranching and agriculture industry, mm-hmm. and to some extent, the oil and gas industry. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's under constant fire in this state, not only legislatively, but, you know, you start looking at these water issues, you start telling those guys they can't use the water. They need to drill wells. The more beneficial use is going to be shipping into the pipeline to Albuquerque. And I think that fight's coming sooner rather than later.
There you go. Hey, Jessica, big one here for you. Is it at all likely that the second congressional district will be redrawn to a Democratic district, or does it seem more likely that it's going to become more competitive, something closer to a swing district? Those are interesting choices there.
We are looking, and we certainly hope that there will be some redrawing of the districts here. Mm-hmm. We don't think that there will be a huge shift to Democratic, but we do hope that it might be one of those competitive swing districts. The possibilities, I think, for New Mexico and Southern New Mexico explicitly in this redistricting process, mm-hmm. are great. We are much looking forward to seeing what the recommendations are at a state level, and then what happens with New Mexico as a whole.
Right. Sophie,
I'm reminded when I was in the legislature in redistricting, when your former boss was in, mm-hmm. and I was on the redistricting committee, and I would get these unsolicited phone calls. I'd never talked to him so much in all my life, from Congressman Tom Udall, telling me what a great seat Heather Wilson had, that nothing should be done to change her seat, that she was a great asset. So, you know, when you start talking about making seats more competitive, you have to remember, when one becomes more competitive, one becomes less competitive.
Fair point.
And the folks that are holding those other seats are not going to be as ecstatic about finding a way to make them less competitive. And think about it this way. Right now, I believe one of, if not the most senior congressperson in New Mexico now, is Yvette Harrell, right? I mean, you think of the people that have left and what's been going on. And so,
Dan, let me ask you this. Do Republicans need to change their message in the face of all this in the southern part of the state?
Gee, we have no message. Our message left about 8 years ago, and, you know, everybody else is the boogeyman is not a message that brings people together and invites them to join your cause. Mm-hmm. We saw that in the last presidential election, and it's going to continue to rain down on us in New Mexico and across the country if we don't figure out a way to build this party instead of, you know, just spending all our time telling where everybody's wrong. We need to leave that up to you and Matt.
Sophie, you got 30 seconds on this.
I'm not going to disagree with Dan on that one.
Yeah. There you go.
But what did you want to ask?
That's right. No. I'm just curious if you had a reaction. And you did. We're out of time this week. Thanks to you all for digging in on the topics this week. I'm back in a moment with a few final thoughts.